Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. If you'd like any of your Ramadan related questions answered this month, you can email us at questions@amau.org.
وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
The question we're going to be answering today is as follows. Does hijama break your fast?
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. This is a مسألة حقيقة that the scholars differed amongst themselves for very long, and it's been an ongoing discussion in the fiqh books. If you go to the كتاب كتب الخلافيات, you go to كتب known as today فقه المقارن, comparative fiqh, you see that there's going back and forth regarding the hijama, whether it breaks your fasting. And the reason for this difference of opinion is there are two hadiths of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's the hadith of Ibn Abbas and the hadith of Shaddad ibn Aws ibn Thabitin. The hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas clearly states that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did hijama whilst he was fasting. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم احتجم وهو محرم واحتجم وهو صائم. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did hijama whilst he was fasting. And the hadith of Shaddad ibn Aws ibn Thabit mentions that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said أفطر الحاجم والمحجوم. أفطر الحاجم والمحجوم. That the person who is doing the hijama and the one who is being done for the hijama, both of their iftar, their fasting is broken. And the views are two. يعني there's the madhab al-hanabila, those who agree with them, and there's the madhab al-jumhur, the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. So the madhab al-hanabila, they hold the opinion that the person who hijama is done for and the one that does the hijama, both of their fasting is broken. Mutlaq and unrestrictedly. And this is the view held by Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abu Huraira and Aisha from the Sahabas. And from the Tabi'een and the Salaf, Hassan al-Basri ibn Sirin, Ishaq ibn Rahuya and Ahmed. They held the opinion that the hijama yuftiru biha al-hajim wal-mahjum. There's also the view of the Jumhur, the overwhelming majority of scholars. They held the opinion that the hijama, it doesn't break the person's fasting unrestrictedly. Okay, not for the one who is doing it and the one who it's being done for. And this is the view held by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Umar and Ibn Abbas and Anas ibn Malik and Abu Sa'id al-Khudri and Umm Salama from the Sahabas. And it's also the view held by Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i and Abu Dawud. And also the view held by Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, Urwat ibn al-Zubayr and al-Sha'bi and Sufyan al-Thawri and Ibrahim al-Nakha'i wa ghayruhum. It's too much. The question here is, why did they all differ? One reason I've already mentioned to you, which is تعارض الأحاديث والآثار الواردة في هذه المسألة. The different ahadiths, the different آثار that have come regarding this issue. The second reason why they differed amongst themselves is اختلاف الواردة في ترجيح بين المبقي على البراءة الأصلية والدليل الرافع بها لها. They differ upon which of these evidences are the bara' al-asliya, the default position, and which one isn't, and which one is lifting the ruling. If the views, there's one which is the default position, then we stick to the default position unless there is what? Unless there is something strong to remove the default position, because the qa'ida is al-istishab, biqa' ma kan ala ma kan. Everything remains in its original form unless otherwise. But they're differing upon which one is the al-bara'atul asliya and which one is the dalil al-rafi' ilaha. There's difference of opinion. The third reason is da'awa al-nasakh min kulli fariqayn. Both parties are claiming abrogation. This group is saying your narration is abrogated, and the other group is saying your evidence is also abrogated. Also, there's a ta'arud in the qiyas, the analogy that is done min kila al-fariqayn, from both parties. The qiyas that they're both doing is opposing to each other. They're opposing each other. So these four reasons are why there is difference of opinion. That which seems apparent to me. والعلم عند الله. It's a مسألة حقيقة طويلة جدا. It's long and it's lengthy. Is that the hijab only breaks your fasting if it weakens you. And if it doesn't weaken you, the hijama, inshallah ta'ala, doesn't break your fasting. And a person should stay away from and avoid consistently doing hijama whilst they are fasting. They should stay away from it. And that it doesn't break your fast. If you are fasting, it doesn't break your fast. And I think inshallah ta'ala, that is the way to bring the both evidences together. Because the poet Sahib al-Maraqi, he said, وَالْجَمْعُ وَاجِبُ الْمَتْهَا مَا أَمْكَنَا إِلَّا فَلِلْأَخِيرِ نَسْخٍ بُيِّنَا. That if there's a way to reconcile between the evidences, that takes precedence over claiming abrogation. Abrogation is only resulted to, we only go to abrogation when there is no way to bring the two evidences together. So what we say is that the evidence that mentions that the fasting is broken whilst a person is doing hijama is when it weakens you. And it makes you weak, then it breaks your fasting. And if it doesn't, and it's not going to weaken you, then it doesn't break your fast. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.